So we have a set of studies that were discussed yesterday and are getting going. Maybe we'll just go from the top down. So Amira, I know that you were talking with Narges and Young. Do you want to talk a little bit about, were you, beyond surveys, were you considering any types of data sources that might help understand aspects of health conditions? Okay. So those are physiologically related sensors. For sensors like that, one is typically in the sphere of wearable type interfaces, and particularly Google Fit is of relevance here. There were some other types of wearables that I know focused on physiological data that Ethica has been involved in over the years, like the E4, the Empatica wearable. The Empatica wearable is notable for capturing heart rate, I believe potentially also EDA, the electrodermal activity, and it claims to be able to record heart rate variability, which involves a lot more than just heart rate. It involves sensing the degree of variability in the interbeat intervals between different heart rates. And our experiments with it suggest that it's pretty spotty in terms of whether it gets good enough contact with the skin for heart rate variability. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't, but one can't premise one's data collection on really good quality heart rate variability data, because it tends to be highly variable in an ecological setting, a setting where people are moving around and sweating is going on, the shift of the device on the hand is notable. Sorry. So physiological sensors typically point us squarely at wearables. They also get into issues of data processing that are more weighty. And so machine learning techniques, optimization, and in general, computational analysis comes to the fore with these techniques. You sound equipped to address those, since those are part of your project. But typically what it will mean in terms of tomorrow's discussion is downloading this data or linking to the Ethica databases to analyze this data that go beyond even what's available in Ethica's Kibana interface, which is a good start. That's what Mohammed has been using there to show things, but can involve creating visualizations of Node. But it involves going beyond that and really using tools like are available in R or Python or available in Spark or, in some cases, you know, time series analysis in something like Stata or what have you. So, not discouraging that, it's just with physiology comes that added need. I will further note that with external devices, such as physiological sensors, come additional recruitment needs and needs for supporting involvement or adherence. So, you know, you need to make sure that people wear the device. For example, one study that is running now and where we have significant amount of data examined caregivers and infants and infant and caregiver mental health as a joint system. And they're actually getting the wearable devices on the infant, you know, requires a fair bit of work on the part of the caregiver and making sure that it's firmly against the baby's ankle, et cetera. So these things take, require effort. They require buy-in or incentives on the part of the participants. But when it can be done, it can be very valuable. We want to distinguish here between two types of analysis with that sort of data, physiologic data. With the current state of Ethica, one has to recognize that the data that you'll be conducting, or the analysis you'll be conducting with physiologic data, with data from Google Fit in general, is analysis that's conducted on the data once it's available in Ethica, which means that because Google Fit wearables, so here you have, it's a kind of a non-pen, okay. I have three in my bag, I think. Cheryl long ago taught me to bring my own pens, I believe I just switched backpacks, but I believe I have some in here. I thought I had three of them last week. Let's see. Okay, my new backpack disappoints. Sorry, Mohammed. Yeah, if I could have yours. Oh boy. I thought I had them right here. But if you wouldn't mind lending. Awesome. Thank you so much. So Ethica serves here as an app. So the Ethica app, say running on smartphones and wearables, can be running on the device, right? And whilst the Ethica app is running on the smartphone, there's typically another wearable-specific app. And this could be a Fitbit app. It could be a Google Fit app, I believe, a separate Google Fit. So some app specific to the class or type of wearable device that you have, right? And the way in which the Ethica system works is you know, Ethica transmits encrypted data. It stores encrypted data on the phone, and then on an opportunistic basis, catch as catch can, when a connection is made, that data is uploaded to the Ethica servers, these protected servers available online. And that's what we access through the dashboard, right? So we have a dashboard like Mohammed's been showing you. We explored some yesterday, and that allows us to, you know, observe this data, right? So data is being collected within the Ethica app, self-report, sensor data, data collected in the background like screen state, et cetera, and that's being uploaded here. And what happens here with these wearables is, you know, the Fitbit or Google Fit data is uploaded to the appropriate server for that type of device. So it's a wearable server. So maybe it's a Google Fit server, which probably goes back to the Google mothership. Is that right? Or maybe it goes back and lives at Fitbit. Or maybe it lives at Empatica, the company. And this is sitting here, this data. Ethica goes and connects to this on a periodic basis and sucks this data down to Ethica. Is that fair to say? So, you know, it goes, and it sucks it in here, right? And that there's tables in the Ethica system which then store data gathered from the wearable as obtained here. But what this means is that you're doing the analysis not real time on this. You're doing the analysis like on data collected over the past day, or data collected over, you know, yesterday and the day before. And that's important for understanding the kind of temporal sequence. You may have data from Ethica that's a little bit more updated than the data from the wearable. The data from the wearable might only arrive once a day, whereas the Ethica data is being captured it's being captured continuously, and it's available on the Ethica servers maybe once every half hour. So you gotta work with that difference in timing. Typically that's not a problem, but it's something you want to be aware of. So you're gonna be doing machine learning and analysis probably between Ethica data, like survey responses and data from maybe screen state and app use and other components in Ethica, linked with this data from the wearable. But the data from the wearable will lag a bit in terms of only being available some hours later, typically, which is, you know, you just have to count on, right? Whereas the Ethica data typically is backhauled and brought up sooner. So that's something to keep in mind. You know, other than that, really focusing on, for example, for heart rate, for respirology rate, what the Google Fit devices are is something you'll want to do. I want to ask Mohammed, in principle, using Google Fit, could I have use of, as a given study, could I have within my study participants outfitted, say, with a Google Fit watch or wristband, maybe that picks up heart rate, but a different device for respiration rate? I can have multiple devices. Of course, you're picking up respiration rate. I think generally those halters or smart shirts like the HexoSkin or what have you, those would probably pick up heart rate as well and do so better than a wristband, perhaps. I'm not sure. Just something to keep in mind about how this system works and something about that, what that means about the timing of analysis. So, sounds very interesting. You might, first of all, Mohammed will tell us tomorrow, I think, in a really interesting presentation where Ethica is going. One question is, if you're depending on wearables, and if there's another route, like web-based mechanism for surveys, there might be a question, well, why do we need this, right? I mean, the Ethica app is sitting here, it's collecting some data from the phone, but if the sensors were interested in coming from the wearables, and if a participant wishes, elects to fill out surveys through a web survey, why do we need the app? And the answer is going to be you don't, as I understand it. You can operate without the Ethica app through web surveys and Google Fit if a participant elects to do so. If they so wish, they can be operating through the through web survey interface, which could be on their phone or it could be on their desktop or laptop or whatever device they want. But you don't need the Ethica app strictly as a requirement. It might make it more convenient to answer questionnaires. You can see them with, you know, when you're offline or whatever, but they're it's not required. So that's worth reflecting on. You might also ask, what does Ethica bring compared to these wearables? I mean, after all, if you have wearables, why do you need this Ethica thing? Well, I'll tell you one really nice thing that we see in almost all studies involving wearables is you want some capacity for surveys. Whether it's delivered on the web or whether it's delivered in an app, having the capacity to ask about self-reporting of why they're engaged in a certain activity. You know, for example, if they're engaged in high vigorous walking, that might be picked up on a wearable, but you know why they are. Is it for health? Is it for social companionship? Is it for utilitarian reasons they got to get from A to B? Is it a requirement of their work? Is it for recreation? These are different reasons we might see activity patterns as collected by wearables. So typically in my experience, if you're just operating physiologic data and you don't have that window into motivations, knowledge, attitudes, beliefs, intentions for the data being picked up, you're often missing out on a lot. And Ethica can provide this cross-linking, moreover, between multiple types of wearables and understand what's gathered on the phone. So even if you're not using rich phone data, you will often use survey data. But Ethoca often gives that picture in the electronic world to app use, screen time, that's also very valuable to complement wearables. Wearables deal with the physical world, and Ethoca picks up these whispers from the electronic world, the electronic context. Does that make sense? Okay. Okay, so that's that study. Just, you know, commenting on some features. I hope people carried away some understanding from that. Gamantha, I know, spent some time yesterday talking with Mohammed, with myself, with TAs, about the details of beacons and beacon technologies. And one of the things that I understand came up, I was thinking to mention it, but I didn't, but I understand Mohammed later mentioned it to great credit, which is fantastic, is when it comes to wearables, we'll be seeing more about wearables on our own data, particularly tomorrow, but it's an interesting feature of wearables that these devices, we can gather that information about contacts between our phones and those devices in different ways. One of the ways is you can place, if you're interested in an indoor environment, GPS is generally not going to get you very far. If it's a indoor environment within a larger building like this one, GPS is just going to be of limited quality, because it depends on satellites that are visible at any one time, and satellites have really tough time penetrating a metal roof or, you know, the various metal enclosures which surround us. And so if you're dealing with facilities, you know, often Bluetooth devices are, in this day and age, a very attractive way to sense location. One way to do that is to have visitors to this area carry phones. So visitors or participants carry phones, and those phones have, let's say, Ethoca installed. So phones with Ethoca, and then you have various beacon-like devices which are placed within this. And you're at a given time, a specific visitor may be in a location, and you can sense how close they are to different devices, right? One point of note is setting the range of those devices is really valuable. Maybe there's rooms that you're in here, and you'd like to know this visitor is in a certain room with respect to a device. So setting the device range to be smaller can actually allow for greater precision, because you know, oh, this person must be really close to this beacon if it's detecting it. If you set the beacon range to be larger, it might seem like it's an advantage, but in fact it blurs where you are, because you hear all these different devices around, and some are more distant, some are closer, and it may blur where exactly you are. And there's very sophisticated trilateration algorithms, including some that have come out of our department through the Ethoca and IEPI projects, which can locate, you know, quite closely where you are when you hear multiple devices. But even if you just have one to label a room, it's particularly simple, and you set its range to be small, and you detect when you're nearby that, and that can give you a sense of where you are, that you're in proximity to this. So one way to do it is to have visitors carrying the phones. They walk around with the phones and they detect these things, and their locations are tracked by virtue of the beacons that they see. Another way to do it is to flip it on its head and have people, instead of carrying phones, people carry beacons. And one of the advantages here is that it may be comparatively harder to get someone to install the Ethoca app on their phone, particularly if they're, you know, if they're a family visiting a patient, in a facility, or they're a patient who comes into an emergency room, you know, you don't want to say, well, can we take the time to install this app on your phone? You know, they might say, you know, what are your priorities like? So, so sometimes getting Ethica as an app onto their phones can be challenging. Now, one way to address it is, you know, some sort of wristband or what have you. So we saw that beacons come in a number of different ways. Another way is a lanyard or a badge type of badge sort of beacon. There are these beacons that come on lanyards, or that can mount on lanyards. They're kind of this size. They can slide into badges. And in general, they can come in all different shapes and sizes, small, stickable, adhesive, etc. And so when it comes to visitors carrying things, it's often really worth asking, do we want visitors to carry phones, or do we want participants to carry phones? Participants being perhaps a superset of visitors, like including visitors, but also staff. You know, who do we want to carry? Do we want them to carry apps, or do we want them to carry beacons or some combination of them? And one intriguing possibility is you have visitors carrying beacons. You have phones that are scattered around the facility that essentially are not being used day-to-day, being carried around by a person. Rather, they are being, they are serving as kind of recording devices, a little bit like RFID readers almost, which sit at various locations. And these phones record and then eventually share back to the Ethica mothership, you know, the beacons with which they come into contact. And there, it's a very lightweight thing. You can have people coming and going without the need to install an app. You could potentially put a beacon, you know, on a gown or in a little badge you give people or what have you. Put it on their clipboard, which they use to fill out their information, and their contact, their movement through the facility is recorded by phones that are placed there, or devices, Android devices, which are placed there. And there's a great diversity also beyond phones of Android devices that might make an appropriate match if they don't need to have really rich screens or what have you. So this is an interesting side of beacons as to who carries what. And it may be that, you know, some of your participants, maybe staff, carry phones. There are phones placed around or Android devices placed around that measure things. And you have the staff also carrying beacons, so their contact with patients, their contact with these beacons are also recorded, but visitors only carry beacons. There's various, you know, alternative schemes that can be used to good effect. But the fundamental picture is don't think that all use of beacons has to be with the Android devices being carried by a person and the beacons being the only things that are stationary. It can be vice versa. So that's an example of a phenomenon there. I will note that for some contexts with health service delivery, there's a great value to also using surveys because you can use surveys to probe why you see certain, you know, inefficiencies or certain long delays or certain periods of stasis where someone's in the lounge for a long time. Often surveys can allow you to probe the reasons behind certain behavior you see. And Ethica's ability to trigger said surveys based on proximity to beacons or lack of proximity for a certain amount of time can be an asset, you know. For example, asking people what tasks they're undertaking when they've been in a location for a long time, or barriers for them seeing patients, for example, in patient workup rooms, procedure rooms, things that have prevented them from seeing patients for a period of time or what have you. So some of Ethica's capabilities with respect to beacons can be a real asset when asking surveys. So contact patterns as measured through beacons as a data source are valuable, but I would argue, like most data sources, a lot of the value of these comes by pairing them with surveys. Without surveys, often you're missing that key human voice and interpretability that you can get through the surveys. And by building in the capacity to make sure that key parties, maybe not visitors, but maybe staff, can have surveys delivered to them, you get that extra flexibility to deliver more, to deliver different surveys in the course of a study. So eating out among patients who are frequent, parents who are frequent fast food consumers, very interesting. Do you want to say anything about that, Megan? Very, very interesting. I could see a rich set of needs there. You know, data sources like that are location-based, like Wi-Fi, or excuse me, GPS triggering for geofencing is something that could be considered, just as geofencing has been used very early on in this whole project with Ethica. A really far-sighted researcher at University of Michigan was using that for park, like engagement with parks, triggering a survey when someone's in a park about park use, and triggering surveys about experience in a park after they have left the park, based on a park geofence, a region delineated as being, you know, a park. That's something which, in principle, could be applied for fast food vendors or outlets. And I could imagine, as what often happens with surveys, part of what my mind goes through is there a way to make the surveys less burdensome or more appropriate or more likely to be to get a response, you know, secure adherence, is, you know, could we trigger them artfully, or at least trigger them with a higher likelihood of being proximate to the time of exposure. So asking a question about fast food now, while they're in the restaurant just after they've left, or, you know, that same day, might elicit better understanding of what brought them there, their experience, what have you, compensatory behaviors, than 2 weeks later. And so it's not so much that the sensor data is always right, but if it could clue us in about when to more artfully ask certain questions, that could be really valuable. And so I wonder, you know, about that. Another thing I wonder about when it comes to food is, you know, is there a role for some sort of use of the capabilities of the phone, you know, taking photos, or in other contexts, it would probably be scanning barcodes or taking a photo of a receipt that someone has bought. This is a really good thing. You know, point of sale data can be really valuable to get, but sometimes hard to negotiate. If you could take a photo of a receipt, it gives some sort of indication of what they bought. They will often be more insightful than a photo of the food, because you say, what's under that? What's under all that mayo? You know, Is that an Impossible Burger or is that a... Yeah, exactly. Whereas if you, you know, there's a lot of information that can be gleaned from a receipt, right? And there might be less intrusive privacy-wise in terms of photographing people's faces, which IRB boards are understandably concerned about identifiability, and photographing a receipt might be something to think about. It's interesting because there's a certain amount of things in Ethica, you know, photography, submitting videos and audio and pictures, barcodes, QR codes, that normally we don't think of as, you know, as sensor data sources, but they provide a lot of the clarity and even sometimes the veracity of physically measured things that can be an asset. And so including them in your surveys, even if you don't include other sensor data or other automatically measured data, can be valuable. You know, those are some thoughts. I know that some people in our group, Young Chin, who I don't think is here right now, but she did some really interesting work in trying to automatically recognize eating behavior based on combinations of data sources. Like, often any one data source is ambiguous, but once you put several together, you might be able to pick out periods of eating. Now, this is more sophisticated analysis that gets into machine learning, but we've done a lot of it very successfully. For example, for smoking behavior. Narges has done some great work there, and Yang has done work. And then for eating is another area we've done work beyond classifying, you know, sitting, standing, lying down types of behavior. We have quite a lot of classification, and this whole idea of detecting eating so we can ask questions, not with the sureness that they're eating, but with the likelihood that it's probably not a bad time to guess they might be eating and ask a question, is probably a good question, a good idea. One other thing I will mention, this is a learning across many studies. There are times where we request that people tell us something with a button. I am eating now, I feel sick, or what have you. But judiciously designed studies, such as that designed by Cheryl and others, have recognized the value of complementing that with questions that are ecologically, they're ecological momentary assessment experience sampling questions that pop up at random times and say, you know, did you eat in the past half hour? Maybe without a lot of clue that you have, but just to double check the completeness of your answer. Erica, who I'm not here, I'm sure is back right now, but Erica Penns, who is here getting her sick dog and gonna be coming back, she did some great work with Narges' seminal involvement, which involves smoking and e-cigarette use. And it was extremely helpful to be able to sense not only when people proactively volunteered information, like with a button push, but to ask, hey, did you smoke within the past half hour? Because what we found is that, and some of Narges' analysis was foundational for this, there's a certain amount of time people forget to mention it, but when you ask, they say, yeah, they just didn't mention it. And it picks up that extra bit of cases where you might miss them otherwise through volunteering. So if you are thinking about volunteering information, or, you know, down the road in future years, if we were to think about auto-detecting and asking, in my view, it's always good to ask some confirmatory questions that will let us fill in the missing ones. Not least because it provides us a grounded way, an evidence-based way of trying to tease out what fraction of the time are people adhering to the suggestion to proactively mentioning it? What fraction of the time are they forgetting, right? It's still within the bounds of self-reporting, but we can gather that. So those are just, you know, some pointers there. This sounds like a really interesting exposure. We should probably talk sometime also about, you might want to see some of the work Erica is planning, but we've done some really interesting work applying Ethica to promotional behavior and seeing how that, so in other words, to what degree is their message exposure occurring and how does that lead to behavior? So tobacco and e-cigarettes is where we focus, but fast food is something that some of my students were quite interested in. Yeah. How does fast food promotion, how is that at least associated with food-seeking behavior at fast food outlets, suggesting menu choices? Cheryl. So this is with four-legged participants. That's very interesting. Tomorrow, as part of our analysis discussion, two things related to this get to are that I'll be talking about with phones, analysis of phone data to determine if the phone is being carried at all. That may sound weird, but you know, if you're trying to use the phone to judge where someone is within a facility, or who they're nearby, or what sort of activity they're engaged in. If the phone is being left, you know, on a counter or a desk or in a handbag or whatever, I wouldn't bet your analysis that it's what it detects is representative of the person, the owner. You know, the phone may be sedentary as a doornail, but the owner's out swimming or something. They may be out with friends and the phone is sitting there. So this question of are phones being captured, being carried, and are they outside or not? We put actually quite a bit of effort into machine learning tools to recognize that with quite some good accuracy. So that might be something to think about. Another thing that I think about, Cheryl, in the context of trying to overcome barriers to involvement with a phone, of answering questions, et cetera, is not only is the phone with the person, but making it minimally burdensome for them to ask certain questions. So contextually triggered questions or questionnaires that can, elements of it don't have to be asked because it's based on context that's auto-determined is helpful. And I know back in the day, Mohammed worked on the tag recognition, right? AirTag. And I do wonder about Bluetooth beacons. We have dogs going around with Bluetooth beacons very successfully and for many months at a time carrying the beacons. Jenna can tell you all about it. I think the beacons occasionally, they're very tough beacons, but occasionally there's a beacon that goes missing. I do wonder about, whether farm animals, whether a beacon is a possible item for detecting the identity of an animal. Right. Some of these beacons can be even stuck on, they're adhesive and they can be stuck on a bottle of medication or something, so, or a syringe or what have you. So potentially, there's even some aspects like, do you have medication with you, or something beyond the cabinet. But that's quite interesting. The beacon life we're looking at now for the service dog study is what? and that's with the Tough beacon, a contact.io beacon. Yeah. So for those who haven't done so, I would suggest thinking about checking out, if you're interested in beacons, contact.io has by itself, not even getting to Gimbal, they have a variety of types of form factors of beacons. Here are some. This is like the lanyard, there's a bracelet or asset tag here. This is the Beacon Pro, which sits below. This is a tough beacon, right? And there's a variety of sorts. This has a slot which you can, the dog's collar goes through, and it has some extra information here. So this is just this one manufacturer, but maybe worth thinking about, given the battery lives have gotten a lot better. Okay, I'm conscious of time here, but just going through here. Okay, so Erica, yes, Erica's not back, I think, yet. The poor pup had a serious skin rash. So here, capturing location, advertising promotion. So there's some really neat work we did, and Mohammed did Yeoman's work, amazing, about it, using community-based mapping of tobacco outlets in the states and low-income communities. So you have, imagine this, you have a large number of people in the study who go hither and yon, to-ing and fro-ing around a geographic area. But a subset of them are inspired enough that they actually systematically start mapping out where tobacco promotion is. Billboards, gas station ads, product promotion and retail outlets in the states, various types of promotional efforts that are, and let's focus for the moment on physically based. Those are placed all around the geographic area. And with Ethica, you can capture the to-ing and fro-ing of all participants, but also you know where the physical exposures occur, because you know where that ad is in the bar for Salem cigarettes, or you know where the tobacco is being promoted in this store, or this billboard is located. And so you can get measures of exposure across the entire study, or at least probabilistic exposure, using mapping of a smaller number of participants. Maybe it's a sentinel subgroup, maybe it's a, you know, activist subgroup, maybe it's just a subset of participants that get caught up in this, as what happened in this study in the States, in Houston and a lower income community in northern Massachusetts. And it was quite amazing, because you can end up tracking exposures across the broad set using an understanding of where those resources are, and track when people do report those resources, report their reactions to them, etc. You complement that with online exposures, which we also tracked, and electronic exposures, TV ads, radio ads, etc. And you get a picture of more place-situated and transient exposures that are more ephemeral but significant potentially, like ads online, couponing that people encounter through sites online, or promotional activities that come via radio or TV or what have you. So here, Ethica can be, again, straddling this electronic context and this physical context. You can capture exposures in those different contexts. And even just a subset of participants can often map things out in a way that lends understanding of exposures by a much larger set. So that's some way Ethica can get into that, leveraging its ability to figure out location and physical space, geographic space, as well as to capture information online. Brianna, do you want to talk at all about potential for data sources related to your study, or are you pretty clear about what you need?
Yeah,
out, there's so amazingly interesting topic, and I would love to engage more substantively about this as well, but I'll just throw some things out off the top of my head. One item is we found that while the Empatica gave sort of quite spotty heart rate variability data for a very high price, the E4 is quite a pricey instrument. Although the folks who create it are academics and are eager to try to make things work. There's better devices for measuring heart rate variability, no question. The Polar, several years ago, at that time, this is probably two, 3 years ago now, probably three, the Polar chest strap, the Polar H7 chest strap, or something like that, and the Hexoskin sort of shirt were both pretty good. When it comes to wearables, as I had mentioned earlier, there's an extra challenge with making sure that people want to wear them, and you know, are willing to wear them. So things like shirts, we found that those shirts were not well designed for women. This is one of the complaints. And my wife complained that the shirts were not well designed for male sweating patterns as well. Let's put it that way. She said it acquired man smell, and she didn't want it nearby. There's some barriers there. There may be some opportunities. EDA, electrodermal activity and related but different galvanic skin response, are, I think, provided on more, somewhat more and lower end devices, but it's odd. Some of them have come to market or seem to be available, and then not now. So I've got to get an update on that area. But I think there's definitely some potential there. A lot of it is about what device is the right one for the job. Is it fit compatible? Where does it fit in, and so on. There's a lot of people talking about that space, and some good hope that there might be opportunities there with some updated understanding of the availability of products. I'd be cautious about partnering with people who are trying to develop products in their lab, just because in our experience they don't hold off often in real world sense. And things are messy. Brain happens. And you need a product that won't get zapped by static electricity. Mohammed has an amazing history of involvement with various generations of our sensing systems, but some of his earliest work is described in a paper from, I think, 2010 or so with BlueNet, and fully half the devices we use, which are really aimed at researchers, these crossbow motes, I think a third to a half of them burned out because of static. This is Saskatchewan, it's a dry environment, and in the winter, sparks happen. And so the devices did not hold up. And so when I say cautious about research-based devices, it's for reasons like that. There's a lot of, it may sound like a great device, but it's a very, it's a quite demanding environment out there among people, not to mention cows. I won't even try to get Cheryl started about that. Wearables have some opportunities there, and I'd love to look at what's available and brainstorm. I'll further tell you, though, that I think you're really onto something with this question on audio and visual components on the phone. It's one thing to get people to put on an extra strap every day or put on a wearable. If you can do something with the phone's regular mechanisms, be it the camera or audio recording, you know, a lot is possible. It's a lot lower burden. Mohammed has done some work with studies that involve schizophrenia, with ambient audio recording. I don't think you talked about that. So that's one component, and there I think periodically it records some audio with. Another thing you can do is actually have a, you know, recording survey that you ask somebody to record their voice. So sampling versus volunteering some information. And I do know that there's been some fascinating work done on, and very extremely effective work on stress recognition for voice. So one of my colleagues from, who's adopted Ethica within the Australian context of quite a larger group there, interest in and seeking to apply it in various studies, Robin Clay Williams, she used to be a fighter pilot in the Australian Air Force, and she says that, you know, in the military, among fighter pilots, stress detection from voice has been established for a long period of time. It's very standardized because you can't easily keep physiological sensors on the fighter pilots and because of the high accelerations involved. And so they do a lot with voice, and they're very good at recognizing stress patterns and so on. And I've heard similar things from academic research involving stress detection via voice. And I think others have looked at, including in our department, stress indications with phone interaction. And this is something where I wonder a little bit, I mean, it may be a stretch, but Mohammed will be showing maybe tomorrow, maybe this afternoon, cognitive tasks. Oh, okay. But the basic deal is by having someone undergo interactions with the phone and look at reaction times and how they're interacting, sometimes you can get a sense of frustration or anger or displeasure, et cetera. I know some people in the HCI lab have looked at, for example, typing, how people type on a keyboard as indicative of displeasure. Exactly. Or you know, clicking, right? and it is humorous, but there's a lot of information there. And if you could, through a cognitive like a structured task, even if they don't think of it as a cognitive task, but it involves them doing something, you know, that's part of, you know, gone through the consent process and so on as part of a survey, there's probably some pretty big ways in which frustration, anger, listlessness, anxiety might show up in something like that. I'm not saying it's a slam dunk, but what I'm saying is it might be easier, or at least another promising avenue than wearables. Because wearables they have power needs, they have adherence needs, they have aesthetic needs, they have just discomfort and issues having to do with maintenance needs. But if you could do it with the phone, it's really good. There have been some researchers also quite interested in pupil, measures of attention using pupils. And I know there's been some serious lines of research involving gaze detection, where people are looking. But probably, in as much as you have a front-facing camera that faces a person's front, if people are willing to live with that, you could, from a video, potentially detect that. I know there's also been some neat work done on using video. I don't know the lighting, how carefully calibrated the lighting has to do, but using video to detect heart rate photographing the face and recognizing that there's slight fluctuations in facial reflectance or redness, per the heartbeat or what have you. So I think there's a lot there that can be done with the phone once you consider audio, video, photos, and processing. It is something that will probably require, some of those avenues would require some significant further investigation. But there's enough there that I think, that's going to be a great area, and it probably can be done in a less intrusive way. I guess I'll just mention one other thing. I mean, this goes without saying, but we think about timbre of voice and people's face and eyes as telling us a lot. But I'll just put out there that I don't know how well studied it is, but I suspect that how someone interacts with the apps on their phone, how their calling behavior, outgoing calls, incoming calls, comfort behaviors involving watching favored content online or engaging in certain behaviors that they find helpful for calming them might also be an indication. So aspects of screen time could be useful. I'll tell you another thing I have a strong interest in. If you think about, I know there's been some really interesting work done on using electronic behavior as measures of mental health. And when it comes to something like Ethica, you think about depression. One of the things that's recognized as symptoms of depression is changes in sedentary behavior, in mobility patterns, in socialization patterns, communication patterns. And all of those, in principle, are within the realm of what Ethica can pick up. Some require a little bit more, with the incoming calls or outgoing calls for communication than is normally packed into, than is supported by both phones. But if you think about mobility, and you think about sedentary behavior, and you think about socialization, those are kind of core Ethica things that Ethica has sought from its inception to address. And, I think of those as other things that might be indicators of mood or of affect or of mental health challenges. And particularly since we have with Ethica this, it goes without saying here, but probably it bears emphasis.